Earth's creation, divine work, not mere chance. So we all know the Bible begins, "In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth." So the Bible begins with the Creator describing his creation work of heaven and earth. And throughout the whole of the Bible, the remainder of the Bible, God's supreme position as Creator and Sustainer of the universe is set out before us. God is the all-powerful, all-wise living God who takes care and in delight and delights in all that he has made. And a few verses on in Genesis 1 and verse 31 we read, "And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day." And further on in the Bible, in Jeremiah 10 and verse 12, we read, "He hath made the earth by his power. He hath established the world by his wisdom, and hath stretched out the heavens by his discretion." So tonight, it's really creation or chance. The earth is a beautiful and a marvellous place, and it's an environment that will support life for plants, fish, animals, and everything that's therein. So the question tonight is for us, how did these amazing conditions come about? Are we a product of a very special creation? Or did it happen by some lucky chance followed by a totally impossible random process? So let's consider modern man's science versus the Bible. Today you find that there's many variations with creation and also evolution. But most people believe one or the other. In fact, today most say there's only one logical choice. Most feel that religion involves faith that can't be proven, and that religion is a money-grabbing scam. Whereas evolution is the product of scientific knowledge and discovery, or so they say. And this sounds all very plausible. And tonight what we're endeavouring to do is show the true facts. And these facts will be an eye-opener. We'll discover that the concept of evolution is still only a theory. And after much effort by its supporters for over 100 years, they've been unable to support their theory with real, firm scientific facts. Do you know, possibly one of the world's most known scientists confirmed that science and religion are not mutually exclusive ideas. Albert Einstein once made the observation that science without religion is lame, and religion without science is blind. Even today, we find that many scientists and highly educated people believe in a biblical sixth day of creation. So what does the Bible say? In Romans 1 and verse 19 to 21, we read here the Apostle Paul writing, "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." Verse 21, "Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened." So here Paul acknowledges that we are surrounded by creation itself and the things that God made, and nature itself provides abundant scientific proof that we are in fact created by God, an intelligent being. So when men support the concept of evolution, they do so placing their complete confidence in the scientists of this world. They listen to the theories as if they were fact, wanting and needing to believe really that there is no God. And if they can effectively ignore the evidence of creation, then they think they control their own destiny. And evolution eliminates any responsibility to follow the commandments or the law of the Creator. who has called all men everywhere to repent. And in Acts 17 and verse 30 to 31, we read, "And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead." So the Bible requires all men and women to follow the things of the Bible if you desire to have a future beyond what we see today, a future, a glorious future. So the findings of evolution, are they fact or fiction? What you find when you look at creation and the latest discoveries by modern evolution supporters, they have a massive amount of inconsistency and confusion in their ideas. Some like to believe in God and parts of the Bible and manage to also believe that we evolved from ape-like creatures. Some are atheists and believe that we came from a Big Bang. But most really just trust it because that's what they've been taught at school or heard. So why all the guesswork? Why all the confusion of ideas? Why are we unable to agree on a concept of the origins of life? Why is it that men of science are unable to agree how it all began? And today there are several competing theories on how life arose on the earth. Some question whether life actually began on earth at all, asserting that life came down from a distant world or the heart of a fallen comet or an asteroid. But we know from the Bible that they are looking in the wrong place. They're denying the simple truth of the beginning of the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the Apostle Paul, talking about the wisdom of this world, in 1 Corinthians, and I've shortened it a little bit, but it still gives a sense. "For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the world, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? Because that the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men are after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise." And I think that's the point from tonight. "And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and the base things of the world, and the things which are despised hath God chosen. Yea, the things which are not, to bring to naught the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence." And also in 1 Timothy 6 and verse 20, "O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust. Avoid profane and vain babblings and the opposition of science, falsely so called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Grace be with thee. Amen." So the apostle here is telling us that the wise of this world will be confused and confounded by the things that are of this world, and they will have no answers, as evolution has no real answers. Whereas the foolish, according to the world, or those that follow God's ways, will understand the real ways of God and the real facts concerning creation and life. So those educated of this world, the real wise of this world, the real wisdom of this world can be in fact very useful. And the inventions and discoveries, you know, such as antibiotics, they've improved our living standard. And the correct use of scientific knowledge is a good thing. But when men unfortunately lie and stretch the truth to find support in their theories, and we're going to see this tonight, such as evolution, they actually deny the principles of scientific research, pushing ideas of what is falsely called knowledge. So no doubt you've all seen, that's what this picture is up here, no doubt you've all seen the Neanderthal man. There's a whole series of men who appear to show a progression from ape-like to stooped over creatures to supposedly modern man. And they're our relatives. So these are our ancestors. It's interesting to note that the description associated with these pictures, and then compare the description of the actual facts of the case. Do you know the skeleton of the Neanderthal man? It was further examined and determined that to be a modern man, but one who suffered arthritis. Abnormal wear in his right knee, ankle and foot showed that he suffered an injury-induced arthritis and would have walked with a lot of pain, painful. If not, it would have been impossible. And researchers don't know how he was injured, but believe that he could not have survived long without a hand from his fellow men. And we read down there further, in 1957, decades after Buell's publication, scientists re-examined fossils. They argued that Buell had misrepresented the fossils of the Neanderthal and was not at all bent over, but instead the individual suffering from arthritis. How could Buell have made such a glaring error in not noticing the signs of arthritis in the skeleton? So in fact, that progression from ape to man, that bent over person, has a massive error in it, which majority of people still believe. Another classic example of weakness with this prehistoric discoveries, and they are, now this man was built up from a jawbone. There's the jawbone that was found. Eventually decided that it was a modern man's, his jawbone. But from that, that is what they've made. Scientists have simply made. I'm not sure how they do it because I see teeth every day. The next one that we're going to look at is the Nebraska man. Now this one is very interesting. Scientifically, it was built up from a tooth. Now that is that's a single tooth that was found from different angles. And it was later found to be the tooth of an extinct pig. And these are from scientific people. We may never know for sure, but it's the most likely explanation seems to be that the recent dig on that site turned up some items of evidence, and completely undermines Osborne's claim, which he was all about the Nebraska man. What do we know for sure is that somewhere along the line, Osborne realised that far from being irrefutable evidence of the comings and goings of an Asian ape-like man, Nebraska man was in reality nothing more significant than species of wild pig. So we came from a pig now. So we move on and have a look at the next one. The Piltdown man. Made from a jawbone, and this man turned out to be a modern ape. Okay? So we read there, following the results show, we'll come further down, the results show that the skull and jaw fragments actually came from two different species. A human and an ape, probably an orangutan. And the bits I've underlined. Their results show that the skull and jaw fragments actually came from two different species. A human and an ape, probably an orangutan. And you can see the different pieces that they've set up to make a skull. And you're going to find out how you actually make a skull. Scratches on the surface of the teeth, visible under the microscope, revealed that teeth had been filed down to make them look human. They also discovered that most of the findings from the Piltdown site had been artificially stained to match the local gravels. The conclusion: the Piltdown man was an audacious fake and a sophisticated scientific fraud. And that is widely known on the internet. You just need to look it up. I know scientists, some of them actually believe in evolution. So there's also another one which I had a bit of a look at, and it's the Peking man. And this man was over 500,000 years old, but consequently, everything has been lost. There's no physical evidence of him actually existing anymore. So the list goes on. Pictures and models of complete creatures are constructed from a single bone, 99% imagination and 1% questionable substance. Life-size models of what are said to be prehistoric ancestors are placed in museums, and their pictures are placed in school textbooks and magazines like the National Geographic. These are all presented as factual of the evolution of man. So there's a real problem with evolution. Evolution actually conflicts with scientific evidence, since it claims that life must have come from non-life. So you're going to have to listen to this reasonably careful. Evolutionists say that certain chemicals, and I didn't know these chemicals, so we'll call them certain chemicals, given electric charge, would form amino acids. Okay, and that can actually happen. Amino acids then form complex molecules in the presence of heat. So these two steps have actually occurred in controlled situations in a lab. Then the next step, so complex molecules must then form protein, the basic substance of life. Now this has not been accomplished in labs or in nature. Then from these proteins, they must be combined to form complex proteins. Now this has not been duplicated either, ever. And complex proteins must then form a cell. Now this has not been duplicated. And finally, the cell then must come to life. And this has never been duplicated. And from Life Science, a pro-evolutionist site, says the appearance of such a molecule, given the way chemistry functions, is incredibly improbable. It would be once in a universe long shot. To adopt this view, you would have to believe that we are incredibly lucky. So, living things reproduce after their kind. And this is a recognised principle of life that you can easily prove from observation and scientific experiment. The offspring of a dog, quite simply, is a dog, and the offspring of a tree is a tree. And neither in fossils nor in current day nature is there any convincing evidence that nature can produce something completely different, a different form of life. The reason for this is that inheritance is controlled by DNA in cells. Each living organism has its own unique DNA, which passes on to offspring at reproduction. But some claim that mutations introduce new life forms. But we know that mutations are almost completely and universally harmful to survival of any organism. There's no proof that mutations have ever formed even a new organ, that let alone a whole new race or a new living thing. And all this agrees with the Bible or creation, which says all things reproduce after their kind. And in Genesis 1 and verse 11 we read, "And God said, let the earth bring forth grass and herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so." So this completely disagrees with evolution. So it's clear, laws of hereditary agree with creation, not evolution. So we have to agree that man is unique from all the other animals and all the other things that have supposedly evolved or created. Evolution cannot explain the difference between man and animals. You just need to consider man's intelligence. Only man accumulates knowledge and passes it on to future generations. Only man communicates by reading or writing or maths or science or abstract symbols. Only man deliberately makes rules. Only man invents tools and machines to do his work. For every kind of animal, there exists other kinds which nearly have the same degree of intelligence. Why is there such a massive gap between man and animals? You know, you only need to think about man's ability to appreciate music, art, poetry, humour, the beauty of nature. What animal creates a joke for the sake of humour? Or works of art for the sake of beauty? How can these qualities explain the survival of the fittest? Another one to consider is man's conscience and sense of right and wrong. Only man wears clothes, has a sense of shame, and also only man seeks to worship a greater and has and desires a hope of immortality. Why are there no animals with any of these qualities? Creation can explain this. Man was made in the image of God. And in Genesis 1 and verse 26, we read, and the word God here is Elohim, which is referring to the angels. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And also, tonight's reading in Psalm 8. We'll read from verse 4 to 8. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the sons of man that thou visitest him? And these verses in particular we're looking at. For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honour. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands, and hast put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, yea, all beasts of the field, the fowl of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passeth through the paths of the sea. So God possesses intelligence, appreciation for beauty, and a sense of moral right and wrong. And he has placed these values in humans. We are in his image. Animals do not possess this because they are not in his image. Again, creation, not evolution, agrees with what we observe. So the universe shows evidence of real intelligent design. Human beings are able to recognize intelligence in work. So anyone can observe a car, a house, a phone, and so on, would immediately know that it was made by an intelligent being. Even if you have no knowledge of that person or who that person was that made it, you can recognize that they're an intelligent being. But you can also recognize how intelligent they were. For instance, you make a sandcastle or you make a phone. Who's the more intelligent? The creation of heaven and earth and all living things shows the work of an intelligent being. You know, think about the cell. It's the basic building blocks of life. It can only be seen with a microscope, yet it's far more complex than any computer or electronic device. If computers are made by an intelligent being, why can't a living cell? Inside the cell, there's genes that determine who and what we are. The information in DNA of one cell is colossal. Who made DNA? Do you know, consider the eye. Your eye. The eye cannot be matched by any man-made camera for its combination of accuracy. You're able to walk around with it easily. Doesn't go flat. The detail, the self-adjustment, self-repair, self-cleaning, and it goes on. Cameras are made by intelligent beings. Who can believe that an eye came out of anything more than an intelligent being? So the same applies to any other organ in the human body. If you turn over the page to just a few pages, Psalm 139 verse 14, we read there, I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvellous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. So creation proves that in nature, all the amazing features of plants and animals and people, they were all made by a supremely intelligent being. And also in Psalm 19 and verse 1, we read, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament show his handiwork. So evolution requires that this all happened by chance. Life began by chance and evolved by random mutations. This has been proven to be mathematically impossible. So living things are interdependent. Like when a child is born, it's dependent on its parents and so on. You can think about that in nature. Darwin's theory. So we all know who Darwin was. Darwin's theory of biological change was based on competition or survival of the fittest. Among the individuals making up a species, he admitted, if it could be proved that any part of the structure of any one species had been formed for the exclusive good of another species, it would annihilate my theory. For such could not have been produced through natural selection. Interesting thing to think about when we look at these next few things. So many organisms and plants and animals cannot exist without another. So let's consider, lucky Rick's not here. Let's consider the soapweed yucca plant. Okay, now this is out in the desert. The yucca plant cannot produce seed till it's pollinated by the yucca moth. But the moth larva cannot live unless it eats the yucca plant seeds. The plant cannot reproduce without the moth, and the moth cannot reproduce without the plant. So what came first, the moth or the plant? Well, in evolution, neither can survive without the other. It's quite an amazing plant. One of the most amazing examples is the yucca plant and the yucca moth. The yucca plant is incapable of pollinating itself to grow more seeds and perpetuate. The yucca moth pollinates the yucca plant while laying its eggs inside the plant. After hatching, the moth larvae feed on the seeds of the yucca. Remarkably, the moth carefully calibrates the number of larvae inside each flower so that the larvae will not consume all the seeds of the yucca. Now this is the interesting bit, because if they ate all the seeds of the yucca plants, the plants would stop reproducing, thus eventually dooming the yucca moth as well. By pollinating the plant, the moth develops food, yucca seeds, for its larvae, while ensuring the plant can perpetuate its own kind as well. But that's not all. The life cycle of the yucca moth is timed so that adult moths emerge in early summer, exactly when the yucca plants are in flower. So how could this remarkable relationship have developed by a random minor change in both plant and insects over aeons? It's impossible. It's obvious that it appeared abruptly, or it could never have developed at all. Evolution cannot explain this interdependence, but creation can. If one form of life developed gradually over millions of years, it would have died out because it could not reproduce or live without the other kind. Out of all the millions of years of history, both kinds would have to have developed at the same time and discover one another before they died. Otherwise, they could never live or reproduce. Creation simply explains that God made the different things within a few days of one another and created them to help one another. The second law of thermodynamics says that although energy cannot ultimately be destroyed, yet it is continually being converted into unusable forms that escape and are permanently lost. This is one of the most conclusive proven laws in science. What it's basically saying is everything wears out. So it shows the principle that nature tends to go from a good state to disorder, such as metal rusts, tools wear out, things grow old and die, phones go flat and stop working. All this implies that the universe began sometime in the past and now is running down. So this really agrees with creation, but disagrees with evolution, which says the universe is building up, it's improving, it's becoming more complex and orderly. And this scientific evidence once again shows that evolution is a false science. And in Romans 1 and verse 21, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imagination, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Creation proves God exists, and he is the only true living God. In Nehemiah 9 and verse 6, we read, Thou, even thou, O Lord, alone hast made the heavens, the heaven of heavens, with all the hosts, the earth, and all things that are therein, the seas, and all that is therein. Thou preservest them all, and the host of heaven worshipeth them. So God created all things. And also in Psalm 86 and verse 8 to 10 we read, Among the gods there is none like unto thee, O Lord, neither are there any works like unto thy works. All nation whom thou hast made shall come and worship before thee, O Lord, and shall glorify thy name. For thou art great and doest wondrous things. Thou art God alone. So it's good to note here that God can be the true God unless he is the creator. So there's only one God, the true creator. And also, we'll turn also to Psalm 95 and verse 1 to 7. We'll just read that briefly. Psalm 95 verse 1 to 7. Come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the deep places of the earth. The strength of the hill is his also. The sea is his, and he made it. The hands form the dry land. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. So the Lord is the great God, the King above all gods. He made the sea, and his hands formed the dry land. And we must praise and worship the Lord, our Maker, for he is the true God. So let's consider God's eternal existence. So if God created the universe, then he must be older than the universe. If God created the universe, he must be eternal. So what does the Bible say about this? In John 1, verses 1 to 3, In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. So God is the eternal Spirit who made all things, and all things were made through him. And also in Isaiah 40 and verse 28, Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. So the everlasting God is the creator of the ends of the earth. Obviously, God made all things. He must have existed before the things he made. And also in Psalm 90 and verse 2, we read, before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. So God is from everlasting to everlasting. God exists and always has been. This is something that man cannot comprehend, because everything we have is finite. The fact that God created everything would imply that he himself is eternal. Otherwise, it would be reasonable to ask, then, who made him? This then confirms that the Creator can only be the true God if he is eternal. Something we cannot understand really or comprehend. No religious system can be true if they worship a God that is not eternal. So in Jeremiah 10 and verse 10, we read, but the Lord is the true God. He is the living God, an everlasting King. At his wrath, the earth shall tremble, and the nation shall not be able to abide his indignation. Thus shall ye say unto them, the gods that have not made the heavens and the earth, even they shall perish from the earth and from under the heavens. He hath made the earth by his power. He hath established the world by his wisdom. He hath stretched out the heavens by his discretion. So what do we make of this? Is God the creator of heaven and earth, or is there something, some truth in this evolutionary process that Darwin developed? What is more incredible is the theory of evolution is generally and universally accepted as scientific reality. The unproven theory is promoted widely and believed by a population that is anxious to replace God and his commandments, leaving them free to establish their own corrupt moral ways of life. And in Isaiah 45 and verse 18 we read, for thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it. He established it, he created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord and there is none else. But there's no real strong case for evolution. And while men adjust the facts to desperately search for a convincing reason to support their theories, they deny the creator of heaven and earth. But the Bible stands firm and true in support of creation. And in Isaiah 40 and verse 8, we read, the grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of God shall stand forever. Because they have been unable to effectively build a strong case for their own theories, man have made every conceivable effort to destroy the accuracy of the Bible. For centuries, they've beat down the Word of God, burned the Bibles, kept people from reading it through superstition and fear. They have persecuted and killed those who have lived and taught the truth of God's Word. But the Word of God has stood the test of time. But the Word of God has stood up against those that hate the Bible and failed evolutionists. The Word of God will endure forever. The fact is, you can resist the truth, but you cannot change it. Believe it or not, the idea of evolution lacks any real concrete proof, whereas the Bible and nature provides proof that we are all the result of an intelligent creation, the one true eternal God of heaven and earth. So, my dear friends, What is your reaction